The first cause argument, part one. I'm beginning this because of a book that has recently appeared called Who Designed the Designer? The book was recommended by Denise O'Leary, or more precisely, Denise O'Leary's friend, on Uncommon Descent. And the link to where she mentioned it is given. And here's the page that I have reference to. And if you will look down about halfway down that particular page, it's actually a third after you get all of the ads and stuff. It's a book called Who Designed the Designer by Ignatius Press. For those of you who are wondering, Ignatius is a martyr of the second century, and also Ignatius Loyola was the founder of the Jesuits. I'm not sure which of those two the press is, maybe both, it's recommending. The book is called Who Designed the Designer, and subtitled A Rediscovered Path to God's Existence. Just came out this year. It's available for those of you who are interested at Kindle and at Nook for a little cheaper than the standard book price. It is basically an explanation and defense of the argument from causes in nature to a first cause. And for those of you who don't want to buy the book, which is understandable, there are a couple of websites that I've mentioned that kind of give the same argument in a more condensed and briefer form. The first one, Peter Kreeft, is apparently for the argument, and of course Rational Wiki is against it. And I'm going to go over the argument, and I am sympathetic to the goals of the argument. The question is there at least one first cause? Then how many first causes are they? The properties of that cause are those causes. And then I'm going to go over some things that occur to me that don't seem to have occurred to the author of the book, or at least not as well as I think should have been. Philosophical problems with it, scientific problems with it, and theological problems with it. And then I'm going to try to put that whole argument in context so that you can understand at least where I see it fits in today's world. Today we're going to be talking about, is there at least one first cause? And the book starts out, and I'm going to mostly read it, but and of course not the entire book, the core pieces of it, at least as I see them. It starts out at first, this, the question of a first cause might sound like a very divisive question which separates us into various camps of atheism or theism. Not so, not really. Almost everyone with a definite opinion agrees that there must be some sort of first cause. Most atheists, especially these days, believe in some underlying matter or energy or basic force that simply is, of which nothing else is the cause and which is itself the cause of everything we see. Believers in gods are surprisingly less unanimous about what the first cause is. Athena, for instance, derived from some sort of cause. She popped out of Zeus's head one day. Zeus himself was a son of Titan Cronos, who was a son of Uranus, the god of the sky. Uranus, in turn, rose out of Gaia, the goddess of Earth, and it is by chaos, the gap between them, that is, Uranus and Gaia, that these two became distinct gods and got married. In this cosmology, no single god was the first cause of all things, but instead some primordial god containing soup lay at the beginning of it all. Meanwhile, the god of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob simply is. So believers in gods also tended to think there is some primal cause or other, some making it a god and some not. He goes on, and I'm skipping a little ways and beginning in the middle of a paragraph. Let us assume for the moment that the question has been settled in the affirmative. There is or are some sort of first cause or causes of things. By far the more difficult business and by far the more divisive is the consequent question. What is it? Is it, for example, something mindless and aimless like inanimate matter or bungling chance? If so, why is the universe so beautiful, orderly, and coherent, and why do its basic laws appear to be a neat custom fit to the prerequisites of intelligent life? That almost sounds like a design argument. Perhaps instead, we should suppose the first cause to be intelligent. Then again, that seems to imply that the first cause involves some complexity of its own, maybe even in the form of a brain. But then, wouldn't its intelligence have to be constituted of well-ordered components designed for thinking? If so, this intelligence would appear to need a cause every bit as much as the human mind does. That's an error in my part. So it wouldn't be a first cause at all. The purpose of this book is to put forward a solution to these vexing questions. Specifically, my intention is to show, by purely rational means, that there is indeed a first cause of all things, and that this cause must be a mind. So far as that goes, this book is indistinguishable from a fairly continuous stream of There Is a God books. So why bother with this one? For five reasons. One, this book takes a fresh, non-polemical approach to the question of a designer. Two, it slowly and carefully develops a single proof for the existence of the mind behind the universe. Three, it does not call you to trust in the observations or theories of others, such as scientists, but instead reasons exclusively from things you can verify for yourself. Four, it solves certain fundamental problems of theism, of which the atheists are aware, but which current theistic books largely ignore. Five, the certainty reached in this book is greater than that attained in science-based books for or against a designer. So, yeah, designer arguments are okay, but this is superior. Were I to undertaking this experiment alone, I would not dare start with these high-sounding promises. He's going to go in a long line of thinkers, tracing all the way back to Aristotle. Problems like these, who designed the designer, are understandably dealt with quickly or not at all in some of the more polemical books, focused as they are on highlighting the many deficiencies of atheistic thought. My goal is somewhat different. I do not aim to defeat the atheists, except secondarily and by the way. The spirit animating this book is not one of attack or defense or even persuasion as much as it is a spirit of wonder. So he's going to kind of, well, this is the way the universe is, and there's really not much discussion, and it's pretty amazing. But he's not going to go after the atheist tooth and nail. As we shall see, it is possible to decide that question whether there's a first cause or not. That's my own interpretation, but I think it's fair given the context. Without fretting over any of the details of evolution or the Big Bang, fascinating as important as those things are. And here you can see his, see, this is superior. It completely bypasses that, those problems. That will leave us with the burning question. What is the first cause? Its very status as a first cause, we shall discover, is sufficient to reveal a surprising number of attributes that it must have, and others it must not have, bringing its identity gradually into sharper focus. Books for or against a designer that draw support from sciences such as astrophysics or biochemistry necessarily ask readers to place their faith in many things, to believe many things. This is in support of his assertion 3. Silly as it might be not to believe these things, some of us wish not only to believe that there is a designer, but to know this and understand it for ourselves, to see it as a necessary consequence of our own experience of the world, not having to trust the scientists, basically, is what he's saying. And so you can see where he's arguing that this is superior, because you can just draw this from ordinary experience. You don't have to be a scientist. In support of point 4, he says this book also explores questions usually left unasked by scientific books for and against design. The intelligent design books of the last few decades, for the most part, attempt to show that living with, I think that's living things, and with got inserted by the dictation and I didn't read it out quite. Living things and many other useful adaptations could not have been produced by the known laws of physics and chemistry. What is the only alternative to these causes? A designer. Which is not quite the way they argue. They also argue that it looks like the kinds of things designers. In other words, there's not only negative evidence against an unguided evolutionary origin for things, but also there's positive evidence that things look like what you'd expect from a designer. And the fact of the matter is that those particular, that particular missed positive argument is one that is commonly made by people who argue against design. And I'm wondering why he takes the anti-design position there, even though I don't think he is antagonistic toward the design in general. But here you can see that his thought process has been subtly shaped by the anti-design argument people. Their main opponents, the design opponents, reply by saying design thinkers have argued against a straw man. Many atheists maintain that organic things are the nearly inevitable products of the known laws and other things like atoms jostling, albeit by as yet unknown intermediate processes. Now, of course, when you say albeit by as yet unknown intermediate processes, what you're saying is that you don't really have any evidence for your position. That you're basically hypothesizing this without evidence. But he doesn't notice the, well, maybe he does. We'll read. If we ignore the intervening steps and instead calculate the probability of trillions of atoms immediately associating themselves into a duck or a street mime, unsurprisingly, the odds are absurdly low. Allowing for intermediate steps, each of which is statistically likely given the previous conditions, well, then we end up with a very different calculation. Although it still may be absurdly low, and I think that's the part that if we subscribe to this sketchy story, it is true that we are under obligation to produce the intermediate steps, or at least to expect their eventual discovery. Well, that last thing is a matter of faith, of course. So that's kind of a... Well, it steps out from what's been demonstrated from science so far. Let's put it that way. So far as these types of thinkers are concerned, those who adhere to intelligent design effectively ignore their position. No, they don't. But those people will assert that they do. Which is, by all indications, the mainstream among scientists. And now you catch another little piece. You see, the problem with intelligent design is it hasn't gotten enough of a foothold in science. Well, it may be a perfectly good argument, and people may be resisting it for non-scientific reasons. You know, this, but the point of it is that what he wants to do is he wants to leave that whole thing in a fog and say, I've got a much better way of doing things. It is partly for this reason that some have turned their attention to the fundamental physical constants, such as the strength of the four basic forces that underlie all statistical laws in effect in our universe. Since these are the basic forces, it is argued, there are no prior physical causes to explain the ratios. Hence, the uncanny ratios must be explained by a non-physical cause for whom the possibility of life is a goal. Enter the designer. This is the argument from the entire cosmos as opposed to, let's say, life in the cosmos. Opponents of this style of argument point back one step further. Before the basic forces underlying star formation is the basic stuff underlying the universe formation. And then he goes on to talk about the multiverse there. Which side has the particulars right, I do not intend to judge. The intelligent design approach and the fine-tuning and Big Bang arguments deserve serious attention, to say the very least. But there are plenty of excellent books out there on both sides of their empirical questions. And they tend to leave a deeper question to ask, what is so special about the designer that it needs no cause? You see, who designed the designer is actually a way of saying, you need my argument. You can't rely on intelligent design either of life or of the universe to make it, to get to it, the designer and specifically to get to God. I have also made another promise. The certainty this book aims to achieve, this is in support of Proposition 5, is superior to probabilistic results of science-based arguments for a designer. My method of reasoning is mainly deductive. By deductive, I mean a form of reasoning in which the conclusion must be true as long as the premises are. It is usually opposed to an induction, which is an argument for a general statement based on many particular instances, such as this. Mushrooms are carbon-based, flowers are carbon-based, trees are carbon-based, bacteria are carbon-based, horses are carbon-based, we could throw in people, whatever you want. Therefore, all living things are carbon-based. And it's of the kind that all swans are white. There are, of course, black swans in Australia. And people used to actually make that argument that all swans must be white because they had never seen a black swan. But he goes on to say, but not all general statements are generalization. I have not inspected every instance of the number six. Yet I am convinced, and so is everyone I have ever met or heard of, that the general statement, every six is even, admits no exceptions. I'm not worried that someone in Australia has an odd six in his pocket. And so he's going to try to make a claim that is absolutely 100% watertight. Most of what you will encounter in the upcoming chapters has been shamelessly stolen from Thomistic philosophy, that is, the philosophy of Thomas Aquinas. But for several reasons, that description of what I am up to is more misleading than informative. One reason it is misleading is the word philosophy itself. I like science. Unlike science, that should be, and that's dictation that went awry. Philosophy in many circles has a bad name, and sometimes it deserves it. skip on. So it is not philosophy as such that deserves our contempt, but just the all too common quack variety. So my philosophy is okay. The other reason that it can be misleading to label this book Thomistic philosophy is the word Thomistic. There's too much of Thomas Aquinas in that. There's the important matter of a new and unified presentation. So he's going to improve on Thomistic philosophy. The label Thomistic also falsely implies that there must be something peculiarly Catholic or Christian about Thomistic philosophy. Not so. Aquinas' philosophy, as distinguished from his revelation-based theology, was not his religion, not a confession of his faith, but an expression of his rational perception of the world, informed largely by the pagan philosopher Aristotle. This book, as for its target audience, I have in mind all educated readers with an interest in tracking down the first cause. If you number among the curious and the open-minded, you may find here some of the answers you have been looking for. Are you an avid reader of the intelligent design books? You can look forward to discovering in these pages an unlooked-for and complementary way of thinking about the universe and its maker. If you're a philosopher who holds Plato, Aristotle, or Aquinas in high regard, I hope you will rejoice to see familiar lines of thought given novel expression with more than customary clarity and concreteness, and even with a dash of spunk. Last, but not at all least on my mind, if you're an avid and approving fan of all the Dawkinsons out there, I have reason to hope that you will come away with a few hundred things to think about. Yes? Okay, so now you have kind of an orientation to how he's looking at his subject. Puzzles about the first cause. Now, pardon me? I'd have to go back, Arras or something like that. I'll have to look at it again. It was in the, I think, about the third slide down. Aristotle did not believe that the world had a beginning. According to him, this world had always existed more or less as we see it today. And here was the mind-boggler. Aristotle was part of the great consensus that there had to be a first cause. He believed in a first cause, but not in a beginning. Aquinas believed that the world had a beginning. He was a Christian. But he did not think it was possible to prove it. He did think that the existence of a first cause could be and had been proved in many ways. The point being is that you can believe in a first cause without believing in a world that began. Suppose you found a cause. Now, supposing this cause in turn has another cause, and so on, ad infinitum. And there is no first cause in this series, and yet everything in the series has its own cause. This is the infinite series. He'll be talking about there are distinct kinds of priority in things, and one of them is temporal priority, and that's what we usually think of when we think of causes. That something happened first, and then something happened afterwards. But there are many other kinds of priority. Among them is causal priority. At first, it was hard for me to see that this was anything other than an instance of temporal priority. So the acting cause and its effect are simultaneous. Leaving aside causes for a moment, consider a similar case of non-temporal priority. Pairs of eyes normally come into existence simultaneously. Nonetheless, individual eyes have a kind of priority to pairs of eyes. My left eye can exist even if I cease to have a pair of eyes by losing my right. Whereas the pair cannot exist if the left eye ceases to be. The one eye has a priority in being to the pair, though not a priority in time. What does this have to do with the first cause problem? It helps to solve it. Recognizing causal priority as distinct from temporal priority opens the door to a first cause of an eternal effect. The great thinkers who had puzzled me so much were right after all. They disagreed about whether the universe had a temporal beginning, but they agreed that it depended on some first cause, an uncaused cause, that is. If the world had begun, an uncaused cause, or some number of them, had begun it. If the world had always been, an uncaused cause was sustaining it and causing the motions and changes we see taking place in it. There had to be an uncaused cause no matter what. If there is no first in such a series of, that is, a series of causes, there are only two possibilities left, a circular series of causes or an infinite regression of simultaneously acting causes. Purely circular causation, he says, is obviously impossible. You can't be your own father, for instance. Of course, that's temporal as well. And I'm going to come back to that point later on. Can A cause B while B is causing A? The answer seems to be that this is possible, but only so long as each gives the other something it does not receive from it. Two dominoes leaning against each other support each other by their opposite leanings, yet neither receives its tendency to lean from the other, but from some influence outside of either of them. Presumably he's talking about gravity. Each domino forces us to look outside the circle to explain why each leans as it does. Why not go, now he's going to talk about infinite regression now. He says, why not go with the infinite regression? When I say that every cause has another cause before it, making it to be a cause and giving its action, why not say? I think that was supposed to be. To exclude first causes in this way, we would have to say not only that an infinite regression of simultaneously acting causes is possible, but that it is necessary in every case. We would have to say that no series of causes comes to a stop, and every effect we see is being produced by an infinity of things acting on each other right now. Not a likely view. Really, though, it is much worse than that. It is simply impossible for any series of presently cooperating causes to regress without a first cause, and so we must admit the existence of at least one first and uncaused cause. So you can see where he's arguing. You can't have circular reasoning. You can't have an infinite chain of reasoning. So there's got to be something at the top of it, because those are the only three logical possibilities. Particular examples will bring out the reason, and we're going to see some of them. Infinity does not have such magic power, then, that it can make a chain hanging without the chains hanging from anything. It reminds me of comments that I've seen in scientific works talking about skyhooks. A skyhook just hanging from nothing. And yeah, you can hang stuff from the skyhook, but then what's the skyhook hanging from? And that's the question. He's saying basically you can't do that. That if you follow the chain up far enough, there's something that holds it up there eventually. And he talks about that's for static things. He's talking about now things that move. Individual boxcars do not move anything except while they're being moved by something else. Infinity does not have such a magic power then that it can make a train of mere would-be movers move anything. So you have a train, somewhere there's got to be an engine there or it won't move. You can pile on as many boxcars as you want, and it won't make any difference as long as you don't have somewhere in there an engine that actually pulls the train. So we can now frame a general deduction of the existence of a first cause. If there were caused causes with no first cause, they would constitute a middle with nothing before it. But it is impossible for there to be a middle with nothing before it. Therefore, there cannot be caused causes with no first cause. Which means if you admit cause anywhere in the universe, you've got to have a first cause. It follows that there is at least one first cause, and that's his italics. So another radical objection to a first cause is that maybe there are no causes in existence at all. Not too many scientists take that idea very seriously, but the 18th century Scottish philosopher David Hume proposed it, and some philosophers since his time have followed in his footsteps. Hume's attempt to cast out the existence of causes is like Zeno's attempts to cast doubt on the existence of motion. You may have heard of Zeno's paradox. To solve them requires finding the mistakes in them, a thing easier said than done. But it is easy to see that there must be some mistake in them, but even if it is not easy to identify it, since we all know we can make it to the door. Hume's attack on the existence of causes is like that, so it need not concern us here. And that's his kind of brush off of Hume, which I think is appropriate. To somebody, especially a scientist, to claim that there are no causes is kind of weird. Now, he wants to make a point here. First cause and God are not synonymous, not even if they turn out to be the same thing. Joe's wife and my sister are the same person, but those are entirely different descriptions of her with quite different meanings. And someone who knows her under one of them might not have the slightest clue that she also answers to the other. Plenty of people think there is a first cause without thinking there is a God. So to get to the first cause is not to get to God at this point. Proving the existence of a first cause is therefore useful but insufficient for concluding that some sort of God exists. It is just the first necessary step. Most atheists are perfectly content to take it. Richard Dawkins speaks of a first cause and of a prime mover. In his own way, Stephen Hawking does as well. So that's settled. We can rest assured that there is, at least, one thing in existence that simply is and is a cause of other things. A first thing with no cause of its own being that has the capacity to produce its effect without the assistance of any other cause. Now, that's the argument to at least one first cause. Now, I have to say I am sympathetic to the goal of Agras's project, and that's the name of the guy, by the way. I am concerned about the means by which he gets there. And I am reminded that philosophia, the Greek word for philosophy, is used only once in Scripture. It's Colossians 2:8, and it's used there in a negative light. And if you're curious, there's the text: "Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and empty deceit, according to the tradition of men, according to the basic principles of the world, and not according to Christ." So, at least Scripture doesn't seem to have a high view of philosophy, so I'm going to be extra careful about philosophy and using philosophy to prove things. Although I will have to say that we're probably all stuck with some philosophy, and so it behooves us to be careful. But realizing that when people of Paul's day heard philosophy, they were probably thinking Aristotle, makes me a little worried about that. Thomas Aquinas, and especially Aristotle, appear to be dated. And if you follow the philosophy of science, you realize that it starts out with realizing that Aristotelian philosophy failed. And so I'm a little reluctant to go on the basis of that without further proof. Secondly, I'm concerned about a God who appears to be unmoved by our choices, which is one of the things we're going to find out later on. It seems the Bible talks about rejoicing in heaven, and I kind of think that the Father is kind of joins in that rejoicing. Certainly the Son. And how you combine an unmoved mover with a human being is totally, well, it's just not Aristotelian. Finally, I am concerned about the using philosophy to correct theology. As some of you may remember, the immortality of the soul appears to be have gotten into theology from a Greek philosophical basis. And while perhaps philosophy may have some insights that are valuable, I'm reluctant to go further without being extremely careful. And I am finally concerned that the philosophy does not appear to have learned anything significant from science. As we will see later on, his approach to science appears to be, if I can put it that way, somewhat naive. And I think that after Galileo, we need to wrestle with some of those questions a little more carefully than what was done by the early Aristotelians, or we will come to the wrong conclusion. And finally, I'm concerned that circular causation is brushed off way too easily. He gives the example of two dominoes that are leaning, but I think that there are some other ones. You can have planet A is keeping planet B in orbit, while planet B is keeping planet A in orbit. The best example is Pluto and Charon, which revolve around a common center that is outside of Pluto. Even in the case of the Earth or the Moon, or for that matter, the Sun and Jupiter, they revolve around a common center. It's just that the center is inside of the Earth in one case and inside of the Sun in the other case. But you may remember all those planetary little wobbles in the star that enables us to tell that there's a planet there. Well, that's caused because of two precisely reciprocal causes. And in fact, they are exactly mathematically reciprocal in Newtonian physics. And I don't think that changes with Einsteinian physics. That is to say, relativity. Because you still have the reciprocal movement, one causes in the other, is precisely the opposite direction from the reciprocal movement that the other causes in the one. And it's not just motion, it's actually change of motion, it's actually acceleration that they're causing. And this appears to be circular causation, except for who made the law of gravity. And in fact, you can take gravity out of the picture. Each planet gives its corresponding planet the opposite force of what is receiving, but if you want to, you can imagine two large balls with a chain between them rotating in space. And as they rotate, each one is causing a direct change in the movement of the other. And here are two things that are each causing the other, so that you have, at least in this case, reciprocal causation and not an infinite series and not a first cause. So each ball pulls on its counterpart by means of the chain and keeps it moving in a circular path. It seems that we can have circular causation. And therefore, the argument seems to be weak here. It's of particular interest to me that the argument, the premise itself, is established by inductive process. This requires a cause, that requires a cause, that requires a cause. I can't think of anything that doesn't require a cause, and that the causes can't be reciprocal. Well, we have just seen I think, reciprocal causes. And so the argument itself is not completely convincing. Now, at least that's my opinion. And now it's your turn. We have a comment back. And we have another comment in the back, too.
Well, this may, despite the fact that I've never thought or brought up on any mathematical things that are involved here. But I was just wondering if you know if a planet is circling, say, in this direction, can the opposing planet or moon or whatever rotate in the other direction? Or is,
no, they're both going in the same general direction.
Always, yeah. That's what I figured.
Doug.
I heard Dawkins on, I don't know, some on the TV at one point, and he was sort of promoting a book that, and I came in late, so maybe you already addressed this, but he was promoting a book in which some guy says that there is no need for a cause for the Big Bang. And Dawkins was speaking very excitedly about how this shows how a cause is not necessary, but he didn't on the program, it's just a brief clip, but there was no explanation of that. Do you know what that's about?
I don't, and I don't know how it would seem to be the denial of what Agras is arguing for, and before him, St. Thomas Aquinas and and Aristotle. As I see it, Dawkins, it is possible Dawkins is correct, but if it is, he's basically doing special pleading. That is to say, if you go backwards in time, I think most people will agree that you can't have backwards in time causation. And the universe being its own cause doesn't make a lot of sense. And so there must be a cause before it. Well, maybe not. See, the interesting thing is that Dawkins is quite happy to say, well, there's got to be a cause of this similarity between, let's say, chimpanzees and humans. They must have had a common ancestor. But, and so you really have to admit that. But he is saying that there didn't have to be a cause for the universe itself. And that's a little bizarre. Now, I mean, if you said, well, the difference between the similarities between chimpanzees and humans, maybe they didn't have a cause, and then he said the universe didn't have a cause, I could, you know, kind of go with that. Yeah? But the argument that everything else has a cause until we get to the one place where I'm stuck, and if I admitted to a cause, it would have to be a non-material cause, and it would have to be a fairly intelligent cause that understood how to make laws, you know. And even if you go back to the multiverse, you're going to have to say, well, what kind of a multiverse-making machine do we have, and is that fine-tuned? So you eventually get back to where there's a reasonable argument for God, and at this point, Dawkins says, well, no, wait a minute, we don't want causes now. After having insisted on them all the way through so that he could make a very old universe and a very old Earth and a very old life on Earth and so forth.
Is reverse causality, is that generally, I mean, not many people believe that's a possibility?
Reverse causality?
Yeah, because I think that you said that not very many people think that the universe causes itself.
Well,
I don't know if that's the same thing as reverse causality.
Most people will say if the universe behaves in a certain way, it's because of some particular reason. There's something making it behave in that way. And that it in itself is a difficult claim to make, and particularly it in itself making a life-friendly universe is a difficult claim.
Is there anything about, I understand there's some subatomic particles that sort of pop into existence, maybe in a positive and negative form, and then they hit each other, and then they go out of existence?
That is sometimes insisted on. What
is
do we do with
experimentally verified?
You're dealing with a quantum vacuum there, which is not the same thing as nothing.
Okay.
And that's important to remember. Quantum vacuum actually has an energy level that can be measured. It's called zero-point energy. So that if you're trying to make the universe out of some kind of field where there's a zero-point energy that's big enough to have universes pop into existence, that's not nothing. That is something. And so that way of getting around it won't, it doesn't get around there being a cause.
And the idea of brains hitting each other and causing an explosion, I would presume that brains would have to exist.
Well, the brain came from somewhere. I mean, the brain was
right?
That's an explanation from a cause.
Right.
Now, I mean, it could be that that's the right explanation. I'm not arguing against that at this point. But what I am saying is that that's not an uncaused universe. So you still have a cause for the universe. So, I mean, these are ways... Basically, what it boils down to is Dawkins is quite happy to have... If push came to shove, he'd rather have other causes. But if push came to shove, he would rather have no cause than God. And at this point, you're going... That sounds awfully anti-theological. Yes, we have a comment here.
If one proposes no cause for the universe, why does one then insist that God must have a cause?
That is a good question. I suspect that it comes from anti-theological bias. We don't want a God, so we will insist that God must have a cause, but we will insist that, no, really, the universe doesn't need one. We'll come to Nick after this. Go ahead.
I've wrestled over the years about the question, you know, why is there anything instead of nothing? Which gets right to this question.
That's basically what his argument is about, is why is there anything rather than nothing?
Nothing. And God, on the other hand, is described as having no beginning, infinite.
Right.
Are concepts too simple? Let me throw in just a little slight curve here that... might be valid, it might not be valid. Our concept of time is considered to be quite subjective by some philosophers. Some say, you know, there's no such thing as time. It's just in our imagination.
Well, even if you accept time as a general concept, time as a concept where everything in the universe marches through time in exactly the same way, is in fact falsified by our measurements. And that's the that concept is the foundation of relativity. And it plays out, believe it or not, in GPS satellites.
Well, this is exactly where I was going in terms of getting into relativity. To me, there are things out there we don't understand, and we're asking two simple questions because we don't understand. Time is variable according to relativity. this immediately affects your concept of infinity, if time is variable. And we're probably, our concepts are too simple for the reality we face. And that is, you know, something does exist. And it had to have a cause, but that is too simple a question.
Well, I tend to agree with you on that. I'm going to pass the mic back to Nick here.
I have two things. One is regarding the idea of time, the creation of time. I would like to suggest that time is a mental construct that we use in order to establish the strict sequence of events. I would suggest that there was no need to create time as an independent entity. The moment there were two events, there was a sequence. One came first, the other one came later, or both took place at the same time. Now, the other thing I wanted to say is regarding philosophy. It seems to me that those who defend philosophy, the extreme of philosophy, is the attitude of saying, we don't need revelation. We can figure things out ourselves. And I would say that evolution has the same or similar attitude. Now, I think there's evidence that this is false. And I'm thinking about the Jewish race. I mean, they are the ones who were, blessed with revelation. Think about the contribution of the Jewish race to the world we have today. The greatest thinkers, the greatest men in history were of the Jewish race in a much greater proportion than anybody else, any other civilization. Yeah. We need to explain that somehow. There must be a cause for that. And I would suggest that because of revelation.
Yes.
Well, I've always been curious about our concept of time. If I was an observer in another solar system somewhere where there's life, my concept of time may be much different than what our concept of time is here. Say there was life on one of our other planets. They have a much different rotation around the sun than we do. Would their concept be different? Because some days there, it'd be daylight for years. You could think of all sorts of variations like this. So the concept of time seems to be only here at this planet where we're alive and we have certain mechanisms that we have created a way to distinguish our history and our future. Some extent, based on what we observe in our universe. So it's somewhat invented aspect of our own minds. God created us to be able to do this, so we know to tell somebody to come tomorrow instead of 3 weeks from now and not be able to distinguish that fact. But another planet, somewhere else, I assume this is different. But then there's eternity. We know things, there's been eternity, because how can we say all this is going to end or has ever begun? I mean, from a Christian viewpoint particularly. So we have different things going on here. When God has done something, it's much different than our concept of what we've done. So it gets very complex as I see it, as a concept.
Well, there's one thing that's interesting when you look at all this stuff, and that is you suddenly understand a little bit more how certain theologians have looked at the universe and God's place in it. I'll just call to mind Paul Tillich, who calls God the ground of all being. He has kind of given up pretty much on the biblical record being accurate. He's kind of given up on there being a God who can intervene even. But there is a God that if you go back far enough, you run into him, and he not only created the universe, but he sustains it. And he'll call it the ground of all being, and he will stand on it. And maybe after you've heard this argument, which we'll flesh out a little bit more in the next week or two, you can maybe understand why Tillich felt that this is something he could stand on rather than having to always concede that the Bible was inaccurate, that the Bible didn't really mean what it said, that Jesus wasn't really the Son of God, that Jesus wasn't really raised from the dead, and all of those kinds of things. But, you see, religion still has an important function because the God that we serve is, in fact, the ground of all being. And when you first hear that, you think, what? But maybe after you've heard at least this part of the argument, it makes a little more sense. Because there is at least one first cause, and the next chapter we're going to go into will assert that there is only one first cause. And if you call that first cause God, then you have an argument that is completely outside of any scientific argument. So Tillich can just wave away, can give up and wave away the entire body of scientific knowledge and still get to where he wants to get, which is religion really has something to offer. Because it really does have to do with the ground of all being. And now maybe it makes a little more sense that what Tillich is maintaining. Now it's interesting to me that this argument is not just for a creator. It is also for a sustainer. It is also interesting to me that it does not. He will argue for a creator that is a mind, and we're going to see that later. And he will argue for a creator, but he will not argue for a creator that is an interventionist. And so he's really arguing for almost, it's not really for a deistic God because he's also the sustainer, but he's arguing for a God which is beyond science and which science makes no difference about. And so from his perspective, all the scientific arguments are really beside the point. They're interesting, but they're beside the point because we've got a God anyway. Yes, Nick.
Suppose we consider the possibility that the designer had a designer in turn. Well, that would negate the basic statement found in the Bible. I'm God. There is no other God beside me. That means there's no other designer. Only one.
Well, I'm not sure that I can say that because I think that God gives us the privilege of designing and carrying out some of our designs as well. In that sense, the devil was actually selling almost a bill of goods. Basically, he could say to Eve, well, you can become like gods, when she already was like God, in a sense.
Yeah.
In other words, I'll sell you this new car that you already have.
It's quite an art to sell you your own house.
There is a legend that that this salesman is so good that he can sell ice to Eskimos.
Well, see, even Satan didn't understand this. Everything beyond his understanding, because he said, I will become like God, I'll put my stars above his. That didn't work either. That didn't happen.
Well,
so his argument was the first failure of evolution.
Yeah, maybe one can say many people, including Satan, have been fooled into thinking that they can make choices that God didn't give them. Whereas they are allowed to make the choices that God gave them. And those are the choices that we should be making. That's getting into some rather interesting juxtaposition of philosophy and theology. And I think one of the things that we want to do is, whenever we see something like this, we want to start asking ourselves, not only what are people saying, but what are the weaknesses of what they're saying? Can the position be improved? And what are the improvements that need to be made? I think we make a mistake to either read this stuff with incredulousness or read it with credibility to say, oh, well, the guy said that, it must be true. On the other hand, you know, if the guy said that, there may be some tweaking that can take place and make it actually valid and valuable. And so I hope that we don't just say, well, the guy's wrong, but we also say, well, where is he wrong and what can be done about it? And where he is right, agree that he is in fact right. Yes, comment.
Quick, basic question. How can there ever be a scientific cause for the universe if, by definition, we're using it a Big Bang as a singularity, which is undefined?
Well, the answer to that is, it's if you define scientific as materialistic, then there cannot be a cause to the universe. If that fails, you can at least say there cannot be a cause to the multiverse. Somewhere along the line, you run into non-material stuff.
Exactly. So no matter what material value you want to believe in, at some point, by your own definitions, it breaks down.
You have to go
to a philosophical argument.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, from a philosophical point of view, one can say that quantum mechanics, the combination of quantum mechanics and general relativity, argues that there is something that can bring not just material into the universe, but order into the universe from the outside. It's not just a random, but it's also organized, so that, for example, two particles that are far enough apart that they can't influence each other by relativity will still have either the same or, in most of the time, it's actually opposite characteristics. The reason it's the same in light is because 180 degrees is still vertical. And presumably, if we had the accuracy to be able to measure, we would be able to show that it's actually 180 degrees and not 0 degrees. But that would take precision that we could not hope to have. The important thing is that that you can't make a good model that says they carry the information with them, because it can be shown to be false by the violation of Bell's inequalities. And so there's an argument to be made that the creator of the universe is also the sustainer of the universe. And there's an argument to be made that whatever that sustainer is understands quantum mechanics and general relativity and can make things happen anywhere in the universe he pleases. It's pretty easy to call that thing the first cause, and as we get along, if there's only one first cause, it's pretty easy to call him God. I'm a little uncomfortable with saying that the argument is better, that he's making is better than the argument from science, not so much because of the deductions, because I think the deductions are in fact ironclad, but it's because of the basic premises. And the premises are established the same way we establish premises in science, basically by induction and by lack of imagination as to how it could be better. And, you know, I have just given one example of circular causality, where one massive body creates movement in the other massive body. And the other massive body creates movement in the one massive body, and the movements, the accelerations are precisely opposite each other. So I'm not sure that his argument is any more watertight than the one on science. And maybe less so.
I think our concepts of the relationship between information and matter need to be developed more. At present, we only think of matter as a medium that can carry information. We do not think of matter and information in a deeper sense. We don't see matter itself as dependent on information. But if we understood that relationship a little more clearly, I suspect that many of these conundrums that now plague us would be easier to understand.
I think you're right. And I think that that is a major point, is that when all is said and done, matter is easier explained as instances of information than information is explained as incidents of matter. That, if you like it, the universe is more digital than analog. And that, given that fact, information is fundamental. Information comes from a mind, and that the universe therefore is more of a product of a mind than it is a product of material. And in that, for all what differences we have on outlook, I agree with Agras wholeheartedly. And therefore, while looking at where I think he may have gotten things a little bit off, I think that he is more right than wrong, and we need to be careful not throwing all of them out and perhaps saving the parts we can. Anyway, I think that's enough for one day. It's a pretty heavy subject. And next week we'll talk about, at least, I've gotten partly through it, but at least we'll be talking about whether there is more than one cause, and and once he will establish to his satisfaction that there's only one cause, then he'll discuss the properties of that cause. And there it gets interesting.